Hallelujah. Doing the will of God. We are talking about doing the will of God. We just cover who does the will of God, who should do the will of God. And we are saying that it's you and I who should do the will of God. It's not just for God to do his will. It's you and I to do the will of God. We have a part to play in doing the will of God. As a matter of fact, that's why the God tell us his will. If it's just for him to do his own will, he won't even tell us about it. He'll get it done. But God wants you and I to do the will of God. So let's look at the second part of this message. When to do the will of God. When to do the will of God. Like I was saying earlier, people leave the will of God to a hazard, to a chance thing, something that happened by chance or something. So they only think about the will of God when it's convenient to them. When they say, well, the will of God, well, the will of God will be done anyway. So they are neglectful about the will of what. They don't even search to know what the will of God is. Let's to talk about doing the will of God. But let's read verse 42 again. That says, say Jesus' prayer. Luke chapter 22, verse 42. Jesus was praying and he said, Father, if it be your will, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And let's read verse 44. Verse 44 says, and being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly. Being in an agony. Like I was telling you earlier, Jesus is about to go to Calvary. Jesus is about to be crucified. He was in pain. He saw the vision of what's going to happen to him, how he's going to suffer. He's going to be beaten so much. He's going to be bleeding all over the place. He saw that he was in agony. Verse 44 says, and being in an agony. So what are we saying? When to do the will of God? You got to do the will of God when it's convenient or it's not convenient. You got to do the will of God when you have to suffer or it's enjoyable. You have to do the will of God when you don't want to, but God is telling you to do his will. When do you do the will of God? You don't just do the will of God when it's all dancing and smiling and enjoyable. There are riches, there is abundance. No. Jesus is showing us the example here that when he saw what is about to happen to him, he was tempted to not do the will of God. But Jesus said, not my will, but yours be done. That means that we have to obey the will of God when it's convenient or it's not convenient. When it's easy or it's not easy. When it's easy or it's difficult, we still have to do the will of God. We don't just do the will of God as children of God when we have it easy, when we choose to do so. No, we have to do the will of God all times. So when do we do the will of God? At all times we have to do the will of God. Amen. Let's look at the third aspect of this message. What is the will of God? What is the will of God? What is the will of God? This is the will of God. The word of God. There's no way to describe and say, this is the will of God, one thing. But this is the will of God. All that God says in his word. What that God say? No, but I'll summarize it for you. Well, I know somebody will say the will of God is for me to have a big car, to have a big house, to be rich, to have millions of money, and to have a beautiful, sexy wife or a muscle husband or this and that. Yes, those are good things. But the primary will of God for you is for you to live a holy life. God is a holy God, and God knows that if you live holy, many of your problems will be gone from your life. Many of the stress that are on you and on me is because of our sin that come after us. The Bible said the wages of sin is death, and the wages of sin have followed us, and we are miserable. Some of all, we are not physically dead, but there are many things that are dead about us. Our peace is dead, our happiness is dead, but If you and I, we can do the will of God. The Bible said the will of God is your sanctification. The will of God is for you to live righteously. If you and I, we can live holy, we can abandon our sins and we can obey the will of God. We can do what is pleasing to God. And God being a holy God, He wants us to behave the right way. God wants you and I to give ourselves to Him and to surrender our body to Him, to live for Him, live free of sins. That is the will of God. Again, the will of God is what it described. The will of it's because of the will of God that Jesus came to die. So you and I, we can be able to accomplish the will of God. Because before Jesus, sin had dominion over us. The loss of the flesh all dominated our life. We were unable to accomplish the will of God. But Jesus came and paid the price. So you and I, we can have the power to do the will of God. So the will of God is the word of God. Now there are two kinds of will in the word of God. There is a written word of God, which is this one, the Bible. But there is also what I call the spoken word of God. Okay, the written word of God means this is the Bible. Whatever the Bible says. For example, the Bible says, if you are a child of God, you should not go after you are a child of God to go marry to somebody who is not a child of God. See what I mean? The will of God, the Bible says, you shall not steal. It's not the will of God for you to steal. The Bible says you shall not fornicate, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not do this, you shall not. Whatever the Bible says, that's the written word of God. It's established. There's no doubt about that. So you begin by obeying the written word of God. The word of God written in the Bible. You begin by obeying that. Then there is what I call the spoken word of God, meaning apart from the Bible, for example, let's say I'm looking for what to do in my life for a job. You know, it's not written in the Bible either I should become a carpenter or I should become a lawyer or whatever. It's not written in the Bible for me personally or for you. There's nothing written that specifies you should sell, you should get into business, like that. The Bible is the written word of God, give you a direction. But specifically for you or specifically for me, I have to hear God speaking to me. That's why I call it spoken word of God. What do I mean? Okay, number one, if you are new to the faith, you have not grown, you have not been in the faith for a while, and you might not know how to hear from God, maybe this is too much for you. But I'm saying, if you know God for a while, and you have given your life to Jesus for a while, the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, can begin to speak to you. The Holy Spirit can begin to talk to you on the inside of you, where you can hear God saying, God want me to do this. God doesn't want me to do that. For example, God can guide you on who to marry or who not to marry. God can say, no, this is not the person I want for you to marry. Or God can say, I don't want you to work on this job. I want you rather to be working on this job. God will guide you. I want you to study this. This will do you better than the other thing you want to study. So that's a spoken word of God that each of us, we have to hear in order to guide our life in those specific manner. Again, the general manners, what is the will of God is described in the written word of God, which is the Bible. But the specific thing, should I move from this state to the other state? Should I move to this country to the other country? You want God to direct you because you don't know what's going to happen over there. So those kind of things, you have to hear from God. Like I said earlier, if you haven't even been a Christian for a while, or you are not completely soaked in the word of God, it will be hard for you to know that God can speak to you. But the word of God, Jesus, can speak to you. The Spirit of God can talk to you, can be guiding you, say, son, don't do this. When you want to do something and you pray, God, guide me, God begin to guide you. Well, it's not easy to distinguish that voice, but the more you pray, the more you read the word of God, the more you walk with God and you consecrate to Him, you begin to hear distinctively the will of God. You begin to hear distinctively the spoken word of God.